I am the only reaction video on YouTube that twerks for Tool. Skadoosh! Welcome back to Morphland. I am Morph. Today we're doing more Tool. Seemed to go over somewhat well. And there was a lot that was surprising to me. It was more simple in ways than I expected. It was more complex in ways than I didn't expect. More so on the emotional side. It was more emotionally complex than I anticipated. Today I'm gonna jump right into it. I'm gonna read some comments from y'all. Yeehaw. Boomershot says, Tool's composition, a movable object versus Morph's attention span. Unstoppable force. Truly a battle for the ages. You know, right off the bat, listen, if every song's gonna be 10 minutes long, you know, that is a hurdle, I will be honest with you. Boomershot says 10,000 days is probably their most digestible work mixed with some of their least. Ooh, that's like my video. Joe the music enjoyer. The music enjoyer, not lover, they just enjoy it, they're not that thrilled. I respect the honesty. Tool is my favorite band, but the fans overhype the complexity of it all. That's what I was saying. Don't get me wrong, rhythmically they are complex, but melodically and harmonically it's nothing insane, which is not a bad thing in my opinion. I agree with that. What I love about Tool is their ability to have that complexity while still being able to emotionally deliver as well, which is something not a lot of bands can do. Okay, listen, so this video I really want to get an idea of the progression. So I'm gonna listen to something from Opiate, their first EP, and then I'm gonna listen to something from their latest on Fear Inoculum, because I really dug the title track from that last time. Just to have that stark contrast between earliest and latest work. Here we go, Opiate by Tool. Hiya! Whoa. Kind of giving me Stone Temple Pilots right now. When you listen to the way he's using his throat to sing right there, it's very quiet and frail. Or like Jane's Addiction. It makes me laugh, like with a lot of Radiohead's early work, just to think of like how far they went, how far they pushed what they were doing for the most recent work. This is rather primitive, not in a bad way, but compared to something like Fear Inoculum, you know, it is rather primitive. Just very different. Love that drum. That's so cool. This is the first kind of atmospheric part I've heard from them, which is pretty indicative of their later work. But they didn't know it yet! Somewhat bluesy. Question. Just do everything I tell. Jesus Christ, why don't you come save my life now? He's a very unique vocalist. It's really one of a kind. They do a fantastic job of getting the absolute most you possibly can out of what just sounds like guitar, bass, drums, and vocals. With some very light production work on top. Ooh. Maynard stubs his toe, man. The song really is a journey. That both works for it and against it, though, for me. I have a feeling I'm gonna be left after listening to this that there's no part I can really remember, or no melodic lines that I retained, you know, nothing that, other than a feeling of like, oh shit, that was awesome. There we go. They're a fantastic band, though, as a unit. Okay, before I start ranting, Bricktown Media says, Opiate is their first EP, start there. And from even back then, you can hear moments and hints of who they would eventually come to be. Obviously, I only know about 4 Tool songs right now from my last episode, and now one more. But yes, they all seem to be very, almost structureless. I know there's a lot of structure, obviously. I'm not saying there's no rhyme or reason to things, but in terms of musical structure, you know, AB, AB, AC, etc. That type of narrative songwriting is not present. They're just kind of flowing. flowing from one section to another, building on ideas. It's more of a themes and variations thing than it is a songwriting thing. And that works for and against it, you know, but all of the songs have that from the ones I've listened to, all the ones from the early shit, all the way to Fear Inoculum, which is a 10-minute sprawling just variation on themes with much more complex production. But this, I hear little elements of that, like there's a reverse vocal happening that really didn't need to happen. It really just sounded like a band in a room. I don't really know if it needed production on top of that, but it does give you a hint of what's to come. So, I'm gonna watch Danny Carey play Pneuma at your behest. Live in concert. I'm a big appreciator of drums. Rhythm is very important to me in music. Love that. Best drummer I ever saw was for Robert Glasper at the Blue Note in New York. I might have a clip on my phone. I'll try to find it. I am the only reaction video on YouTube that twerks for Tool. Subscribe for Tool twerking. Come on, Danny. Daniel. Danny boy! See, I love that shit because it's such a clearly odd-metered part that you're not even expected to get it on the first couple listens, I'm sure. You really gotta tune into that. But to take silence and turn it into a groove in such an odd-metered way, it takes a lot of skill. It's very easy to fill that bar with just notes, but he does it in a way where it doesn't feel like it's like... Become Pneuma. Pneuma, Pneuma, yay! Great live mix. My dude is jacked. My dude is ripped like a piece of paper. Yeah! They're so tight. I've talked about this before, but the Miles Davis concept of, he talks about, you know, for his example, for the quintet, five musicians being one sound, turning his hand like that, you know? It's one thing coming out of the speakers. This band really exemplifies that. Playing drums be like, if anyone at home has never played a drum kit, I highly recommend. It is very fun to hit things under the guise of art. Oh yes, dynamics. Wow, he's very steady. I can't tell if that drum is a sample or a real thing, just because it's so perfectly tuned. Ooh, I think that's to D. I love that. Doom, 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 doom. Just never stopping, overlapping the bar line. I would assume he's performing to a click in his ear, but it's still impressive. This part to perform as a drummer is super fun because you just have, you know, I do two hits here, two hits there, but I can choose any part of the drum kit I want. They call that orchestrating when you're playing drums. You have a specific rhythm, but you can arrange it any way you want with any specific part of the kit. But you get to see him just, you know, deciding where to place each hit. It's nice to have a window into his perspective as well. American Express! Oh, yeah? Oh, I'll sign up for a credit card right now. Luckily, I grew up on the stupid farm eating nothing but moron seeds. It's not far off from Opiate, I have to say. There's more space and to develop ideas and grow. Time signatures are more complex. Rhythmic ideas are more complex. Less James. And the guitar effects and the bass effects have gotten much more spacey and nuanced. It's part of the songwriting now, it's not just distortion. Opiate was giving me Black Flag, and this is giving me... I don't know what this isn't its own thing for now. I don't know what you would equate this to. Jacked Leprechaun. My dude can have my Lucky Charms. That's really cool to see, the progression. Even though, okay, there's a lot of progression, but there's also not a lot of progression. What's coming to mind is there is a very, very kind of outsider music, but very classic jazz artist named Sun Ra, who believed he was from Jupiter, and I believe he was telling the truth. I don't think he was right, but I believe he was telling the truth. And his band would, you know, he called it his orchestra, his arc. His orchestra, Sun Ra and his orchestra. And they have a lot, like, they have a couple famous songs called like Space is the Place. But, you know, in order to have an audience be receptive to this out there weird shit that they wanted to play, that Sun Ra wanted his orchestra to play. You know, I remember this one concert I was watching one time on YouTube. Obviously they were around before my time. The first song they played, I think it was a Frank Sinatra song. I'm not remembering correctly probably, but it was a classic big band tune, just perfectly swung. And then the next song was the most dissonant, out there, avant-garde shit you've ever heard in your entire life. But you have to show the audience that you know how to do the right thing, the conventional thing, before you can show them that, you know, this is what we want to do. And having the audience understand the difference and trying to understand the intention behind that, that's what drives music forward. So it's cool to see, like, almost their garage rock beginnings, and now they're... I can honestly see why it would turn fans off, though. I remember Fear Inoculum, just it having... I can imagine the Pro Tools session for that having 300, 400 tracks, you know, probably 50 just guitars. So I can definitely see that turning off certain fans, because on one hand you have something so pure in Opiate, but then something so complex with Fear Inoculum. But to me, they're both kind of the same thing, just spoken with a different color palette. Yeah. Okay, guys, I gotta wrap it up. I got places to be. So thank you for watching. Next episode, I'm gonna listen to the pod. I'm sorry I promised that, but next episode, I promise I got you. And I'm enjoying my Tool journey, and that's something I never thought I would say. Maybe I'll buy a cock and ball shirt. Please subscribe. Also, we're releasing live sessions, performances by Morphland, my band, every week. I will link that after I disappear. Please subscribe. Please subscribe. Help us hit 1,000 subscribers by the end of February, and goodbye.